sisters and brothers, it's my great pleasure to introduce to you our next speaker. I don't think I have to tell anyone in this room that our president, Fred Hahn, is a union leader like no other. Who else could get Catherine Swift, that horrible right-winger from the CFIB who hates unions, to admit that Tim Hudak's plan to cut corporate taxes makes no sense? While also inspiring the creation of the hashtag MoreBoa on Twitter, or a campaign to make a real Fred bobblehead. He's respected across the provinces by friends and enemies alike for his knowledge and passionate defense of public services and CUPE members. And he's appreciated here inside of CUPE Ontario for the joy, exuberance, and self-depreciating humor he brings to that work. But sisters and brothers, for all the fun that Fred is, and I know you appreciate, he is always deadly serious, principled, and driven in his desire to put the members' interests first. And that's why I'm proud to be an officer with him and to welcome him to our convention. Join me in welcoming our president, Brother Fred Hahn.
Thank you very much, all of you, and thank you, Candace, for that warm introduction. And, you know, if this was a normal time, I would deliver a regular convention report to you as your president, but, sisters and brothers, we're not in a normal time. As we meet in the convention, we are in the middle of a provincial election where there is so much at stake. It is quite literally the election of our lifetime, and it is an election where everything seems somehow upside down, where what we used to think of as left is sounding right, and where what is right off the map, and where the media is telling us that the government that brought us austerity budget after austerity budget and Bill 115 that legislated away the free collective bargaining rights of our members is somehow the progressive choice. The first few weeks of this provincial election campaign have been crazy-making, and I'm from Toronto, and the whole world knows how elections can go deeply weird there. Just look at our mayor. So in thinking about how I would report to you, I thought I would start by talking about us, about who we are. Because for me, when the world is mixed up and upside down, I always think about us as the fixed point that I can rely on. We're CUPE. We are the largest union in this province, in this country. Our members are everywhere, in every city, town, and village, in every corner of Ontario. We make a difference every day, not just because of the amazing public services our members deliver just by going to work, but because of who we are as a union. We are principled and focused. We are progressive and inclusive. We are a militant, mobilizing union that works in coalition with others. We understand social solidarity. We stand with those not in a union. We are strong. We are a force to be reckoned with. We are the instigators. We are the agitators. We are the change makers. That is who we are as CUPE. And our members have proved it like never before this year. In universities like at Trent, where Local 3205 stood up against a powerful multinational food corporation trying to strip their collective agreement, and they beat back that attack. At 4600, the University of Carleton, where they mobilized the whole university community against concessions and won gains for their members in their collective agreement. Our members here in Windsor, Local 1393, who went on strike to defend their services, and using the creativity of their members, they won too. And then there's Local 1281. At Ryerson, two members resisting a bullying employer locked out for over 100 days, but at the end of it, they not only maintained their collective agreement, that bully of an employer had to resign. And we've got our healthcare sector, with hospital workers campaigning against bed closures in community after community, exposing the shameful treatment of acute care patients being pushed out of hospitals trying to save money, and Ochu bucking the Liberal government's wage-freeze agenda, achieving wage increases in every year of their central agreement, as well as real improvements to working conditions as well. And our long-term care members standing up against cuts in every community, like at the Davie Home in Sault Ste. Marie, where they are generating huge public support against cuts to services and jobs there. Can you imagine? We're cutting hours of care when we need more. It is why our healthcare workers will campaign to make sure we have legislated hours of care for seniors in long-term care, and we will keep doing that until we have won. In social services, developmental service workers campaign community after community. They got agreement on a special legislative committee to focus on the crisis in developmental services. Our members made a service that no one was talking about headline news across Ontario. Our childcare workers standing up to defend their centres from closure, working with parents. Their activism has put childcare as an issue on the agenda for this election. Child welfare workers, whose employers had their budgets cut by the provincial government, and they have proposed closing for 5 days to balance the books in various communities. But starting in Hamilton with a massive rally and working through every last local where this has been proposed, our CAS members have reversed those plans to close for 5 days everywhere they've been proposed by the employer. Our equality committees have been growing our participation in events like Pride and Caravana or Carnival, focused on our services, on the message that CUPE stands up for fairness. Heck, at Carnival last year, CUPE members won an award for the entry that we put into that festivity. We are award winners, my friends. We stand for justice with all workers, for the whole working class. We supported the demand for a $14 an hour minimum wage with so much success that we are not just debating if we should raise the minimum wage, but by how much. And we are standing with OCAP and other anti-poverty activists to demand an increase to social assistance rates, making sure that this important issue is also on the public agenda. And we have gained recognition from the Broadbent Institute, who has said that this kind of coalition work is the example of the kind of work that unions must be doing. CUPE is the example, my friends, for others in our movement. And along with other unions, we have been building the strength and reinforcing the base of our union, ensuring that clear connection with our members, with Stand Up for Fairness. We started that enormous task a year ago, but we have made real headway. More than half of our locals have been trained, have the tools to start that on-the-ground work with their members, and more locals than that are using Stand Up for Fairness in their campaign work, in their bargaining. At its heart, Stand Up for Fairness is about one-on-one conversations with our members. It's about that face-to-face talk, not just talking to our members, but listening to them as well, hearing their issues, their concerns, making sure we have that connection. Conversations are the method, but make no mistake, the purpose is to build power, and we are building power in CUPE with Stand Up for Fairness. That is also part of who we are. And it's no surprise that our school board locals have been leading in this way, because those workers remember the fight against Bill 115, they remember the power they built through mobilizing, and they used it again this year with school boards who were refusing to honor their agreement. In bone-chilling temperatures, in protest after protest, our members put pressure on boards, making them reverse their decision and winning. And our school board locals have taken the historic decision, even after all they have been through, to stay together, to bargain together with every local who took a vote on central bargaining, agreeing to stay together. That's amazing, my friends. Our municipal locals have been standing strong against concessions, like Locals 1 and 2 in Toronto, long list of concessions, and in both places, they got them gone. Local 94 in the city of Whitby, the Durham Region employees, Local 1764, just two examples of two locals who have strike votes of well over 90% standing strong against concessions. Our locals have been active in municipal budget processes, have been fighting service reviews. From Guelph to Ottawa, we are winning the right to represent more workers, growing our union. And then there is the power, the sheer force of will, the incredible strength and courage that is Local 4616 in Bonfield. These workers have been standing strong for over 10 months against concessions, refusing to be bullied by their employer, making huge sacrifices, not just for themselves, but for all of us. It's truly inspiring and amazing. And look, this isn't even the whole picture of who we are. Some of you are saying, I bet, well, he didn't talk about this, and he didn't mention that. And you would be right, because I only have 20 minutes, and there's no way I can fit it all into 20 minutes. But I hope that this glimpse, just from this year, will help us to remember that fixed point of who we are when we're at this convention, in the middle of an election, when a politician like Tim Hudak wants to run Ontario. Now, I don't think I need to tell any of you in this room that sometimes in our movement, it can be a difficult thing to get agreement. There are lots of issues, lots of points of view. It can be a challenge. But there is absolute agreement from every union in the labor movement, from every coalition partner and community group that we work with, that the number one goal of this provincial election is to stop Tim Hudak from becoming the premier of the province of Ontario. And you know, the start of Hudak's campaign really told us all we needed to know about how he'd run the province. This was him getting kicked out of the Toronto Transit Commission with the media in tow. Did you see it? It was very telling. Hudak and the Tories had a half-baked plan for that event. They didn't do their homework. They didn't have their facts. They broke the rules. In this case, the one against campaigning on the TTC during an election. And when transit officers, just doing their job, called them on it, they held up a vital public service, inconveniencing the public who were using it. And instead of taking responsibility for their ill-conceived and messed up plan, they blamed the workers and CUPE, who is, we are proud, of course, to represent them. That's right. That's right, he blamed workers and he blamed CUPE because that's his go-to place. It's raining outside, blame CUPE. My hair is not good today, must be CUPE. But I digress. Seriously, this guy's plan for the province is an even worse, a worse epic fail than that press conference was. In particular, his plan to get rid of 100,000 public sector jobs, fire 100,000 people. Now, in case you are having a hard time trying to visualize what that might look like, you need to take a look at this. This is a crowd of 100,000 people. That is how many jobs Tim Hudak is committed to destroying if he is elected. And since this massive number of people exceeds the number of people directly employed by the provincial government, we know it will spill into the broader public sector. We know it will impact our members. He has been clear, in fact, that he will fire 10,000 school board support workers. It's not clear whether that's part of his 100,000 or on top of it. He won't say. But it would mean that jobs would disappear, services would disappear in hospitals, universities, long-term care, child care centers, supports for people with disabilities, even municipalities, because he said he'll cut their transfer payments to make them do it. Losing 100,000 jobs would hurt every community in Ontario, and there would be real spill-off impacts in the private sector. Because you see, every public sector job generates economic activity. It helps to support private sector jobs. And when you get rid of 100,000 public sector jobs, there will be a corresponding loss of up to 67,000 private sector jobs as well. I am very proud of the work that our union has done to break this down, to make it real, city by city, town by town, what this plan would mean, and it is gaining attention. In Windsor, it would mean the loss of 3,964 jobs, increasing the unemployment rate to over 11%. In Sudbury, it means losing 2,785 jobs. In Peterborough, the unemployment rate would go to 14.8%. In Niagara, we would lose 5,300 jobs. In Ottawa, 11,000. You get the picture. Can you believe he is actually saying that this is part of his plan to create jobs? What jobs? like the 3 part-time jobs my nephew has because he can't find full-time work, and neither can his partner, who's also working part-time because while they're trying to raise their little daughter. You just ask any young person, anybody unemployed looking for work, and they will tell you, good, full-time, permanent jobs are being replaced with part-time, precarious ones. And HUDAC wants to get rid of 100,000 full-time jobs. This will throw our economy into a tailspin. It will undercut any of the fragile recovery that has started. But you see, he doesn't care about that. He's running on ideology. We know how this story goes. It is the public sector that is to blame. We are bloated. We must get rid of the fat. Our members, helping to support our parents live with dignity in long-term care, supporting kids with disabilities in our schools, looking after infants in childcare centers. These workers are not fat. They are essential to our collective success as a province. But wait, as they say in the crazy infomercials, there's more to Tim's plan. Because on top of killing jobs, he wants to starve government by slashing corporate taxes by an additional 30%. Now, the Liberals have already lowered corporate taxes to the lowest rate they have been since the 1930s. The governor of the Bank of Canada has said that profitable corporations are sitting on more than $500 billion in profit that they are refusing to spend to create jobs. But HUDAC thinks they need more money. HUDAC says the reason we don't have jobs is because we haven't given enough tax breaks to corporations. Never mind that this hasn't worked. Never mind it hasn't worked anywhere around the world where it has been tried. You know the saying that the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. I am here to say that these right-wingers that want to keep cutting corporate taxes, thinking it'll create jobs, are just insane. And this proposed corporate tax break would rip $2 billion a year out of our economy. Just imagine what would need to be cut to deal with that. He says it'll create jobs. All it will create is crisis, the kind of crisis they want, because they also want to sell off and contract out the public services we own in common, saying we can no longer afford them. This is the cold, hard truth of HUDAC's plan for our province if he's elected. But while I am up here talking the truth, I got to tell you a little bit more truth. And that is about what the media is calling the Liberals' progressive budget. Under the Liberals, in the last 4 years in Ontario, we have seen more severe cuts to our services than we saw in the whole decade before that. That budget contained and maintained the austerity funding that have caused hospital beds to be cut, CESs to close for 5 days, hours of care and wait lists to grow in long-term care. Now, it put money into wages for PSWs and childcare, and that is necessary and important, but it took that money from other services. It taxed the wealthiest Ontarians, and that's something in CUPE we should be very proud of because we have been campaigning on that for a long, long time, but it didn't go after the real money. It didn't touch corporate tax cuts. And all of the infrastructure investment that they are crowing about in hospitals, in schools, and in transit were followed in the budget documents by pages and pages praising P3s. So the idea that this is the most progressive budget we've seen in 20 years somehow just says something really bad about the last 20 years in Ontario. And the saddest thing about this election is that the media has just bought it, and that the NDP haven't really challenged it. They have added some good things in their platform. They say they would hire 1,000 education assistants. They would help to fund childcare centers to stay open. They would prevent school closures. They are the only party promising to increase corporate taxes. But that has been mixed with language from Andrea Horvath that sounds like nothing we expect to hear from the NDP. It is why, in our collective name, I have been openly and publicly critical of Andrea during this campaign, and it's why I understand, in this weird, mixed-up time, when many of us didn't want an election in the first place, that we might be having a hard time getting revved up about this election. But now we are in this election, and we need to focus, and our focus clearly and absolutely must be stopping Tim Hudak. That does not mean that we are going to abandon working with pro-worker NDP candidates as our action plan called for last time. That does not mean we are going to ignore the people who have been working right alongside us for the things that we care about, like Sherry DeNovo, who's been fighting with ambulance paramedics to have PTSD recognized as an occupational disease, like Peter Tabbins, who worked with our school board members on Bill 122, the piece of legislation about central bargaining, to make sure it was amended to respect our members' rights. We need politicians like this in the legislature. They deserve our support. And our focus on stopping Tim Hudak has to also mean that we are clear we need to deny him seats. And so what that means in a place like London West or Niagara Falls or Kitchener-Waterloo is that it is good that our members are already there supporting Peggy Sattler, helping Wayne Gates, canvassing for Catherine Fife to get them reelected, because if they are not reelected, it is Tim Hudak and the Conservatives that will take those seats. But the most critical part of this election to defeating Tim Hudak is all of us and our members. This election, this time, to truly defeat him, we all need to be in the game. We need to be talking to our members about the threat of Hudak's plan, what it means to our services, to our communities, to our jobs, to our economy. We need our members to be talking to their families and to their friends and to their neighbors. Every vote we deny him is a very good thing. Now, I know some of you, look, it's not the time to be saying we just don't talk about locals or politics in our local. I know some of you don't. Now is the time that you need to start. Each and every one of us in this room, members, staff, activists, we all need to be dedicated in the next 2 weeks to preventing Tim Hudak from becoming premier. We've got 2 weeks to get information to our members, to help them to understand that their vote matters and that they must use it to protect public services and to stop Tim Hudak. The work of the labor movement is having an impact. The OFL's Stop Hudak meetings have been massive wherever they have been held, and in almost every community where they've happened, KUPE members have been the largest group in attendance from any union. That inspires me. It helps to remind me of who we are. Just like seeing all of you, feeling the power in this room, knowing that we are just the tip of the KUPE iceberg. I believe in my heart, I feel it in my soul. I have seen it with my own two eyes. We have everything we need to stop Tim Hudak. And if, in the next couple of weeks, you have a moment of doubt, you just need to remember who we are. We are the instigators. We are the agitators. We are the change makers. And if Hudak gets elected, by God, we'll be the frickin' troublemakers as well. But it is possible to prevent that from happening, sisters and brothers. With the power of KUPE, with the power of our coalition partners, we can do anything. We can fight for our members. We can create good jobs in our communities. We can defend our services. Hell, we can improve them so they're better for our kids and their kids. We can raise the minimum wage so the lowest workers aren't locked into poverty. We can raise social assistance rates so that we start ending poverty instead of guaranteeing it. We can bring more workers into our movement so that they know the power of being in a union. We can make the rich pay their fair share, make corporations pay their fair share, bring real tax fairness to Ontario, and we can stop Tim Hudak from becoming the premier of the province of Ontario. We can do it together, my friends, with our families, our communities, our neighbors, together. Anything is possible. Have a very good convention.